Hello everyone, I am Vasavee Vijayaraghvan and I am a solutions architect for media at Intel. And I work at the Visual Cloud Division in the Data Center Group with Intel, and I'm here today to speak about perceptual video quality. Before I get into the actual content, I just thought I can spend a little bit of time introducing myself. So I graduated as a master's thesis researcher from the University of Texas at Arlington and under the guidance of Dr. K.R. Rao. And I do have some of the fellow researchers in this room right now. I specialized in video encoding, and I joined Intel's Visual Cloud Division as an intern in 2015, and I've been working with this group ever since on media delivery part of the video pipeline. And I work with a lot of major cloud service providers on the media delivery part again. And video quality analysis is of prime interest and importance as a part of my role. So here's the flow of my talk. We'll be looking at, first off, why video quality assessment is important. And then we'll move on to two main video quality assessment methods that we have known and used. I do highlight the advantages of using objective metrics before showing the data points for the drawbacks that we experience with the objective metrics. Next, we move on to the difficulties in using subjective testing, yet the bigger advantage. The final section of this talk is going to be a recommendation methodology that can be adopted to sort of semi-automate the subjective MOS testing. I do want to highlight two things here before we go on into the sections. MOS, or mean opinion score, is a VQ metric that I've used for subjective testing, and it ranges from 5-to-1 scale, with 5 being the highest. And SVT HEVC, which is a scalable video technology HEVC encoder, is the encoder that I've used for all of my analysis that I'm showing in this presentation. SVT HEVC is Intel's HEVC compliant open source software encoder that achieves excellent density to quality trade-off and is highly optimized for Intel Xeon Scalable and Xeon D platforms. There are about 13 quality density levels available with this software encoder, and it's also available in both subjective and objective modes. It's all open source and available in Git page. I would have given the link later in the presentation. So this is just a graphical data from Cisco that on the left-hand side that actually shows that internet video share of the total internet traffic increases to about 80% by 2021. This means that we should consume or spend bits more wisely than we do right now, to accommodate this growth in usage that we see here. So this in turn does mean that we need to continue to look for better compression algorithms to deliver good quality video at an affordable bitrate. An extensive video quality analysis in any stage of the media pipeline is of significant importance to make sure that A, the end user consumes a near distortion-free video, and B, use the bits wisely to deliver a good quality video. So the next section is just a little bit of overview about the objective metrics that we all know that's pretty popular, and the known advantages and the gaps in there. I'm pretty sure all of you know about SSIM and PSNR, but SSIM does compute the structural difference between the reference and the compressed video, and it takes into account luminance and contrast masking. And we know that 1 is the highest value for SSIM and is calculated on a block basis. And PSNR, on the other hand, computes the difference in noise between a reference and a compressed video. And an advantage with PSNR is that it gives higher weightage to the luma or light components, since a human visual system is more sensitive to that. So these are the inherent advantages that we know exist with objective metrics, that they are faster in time to compute, and you can easily automate a whole batch of videos if you want to test the metrics with these. And we do know that a lot of frameworks such as FFmpeg have these filters integrated right into them, so it's easier to pick and use. So this is one of the key slides that actually highlights the gap that we see in using the objective metric. The graph on the left-hand side that you're seeing is actually an incremental bitrate and PSNR graph with bitrate shown on the x-axis and PSNR shown on the y-axis. As the quality level increases, so does the bitrate consumption. So point A is the highest quality point, consuming the highest bitrate, and point B is the second highest quality point. If you look at the videos on the right-hand side now, these two videos are actually corresponding to these two quality points. I'm not sure how this is seen in the screen, but will you be able to take a guess at which one is which? Oops. Sorry. I didn't mean to do that. Okay, now that I have already revealed the answer, I'm sure half of you guessed it right, and probably the other half didn't, which actually puts at an advantage, saying that it's subjectively imperceivable, the difference between the two. But the PSNR metric shows otherwise. The 1.5 dB delta that you're seeing over there is consistent going from the lowest point to the highest point. So when you look at the PSNR metric itself, there is a difference between these two points at an expense of 17 megabits per second bitrate. But when we are actually looking at the video, we are not able to see it. So that's the whole point of that slide, that although we do have an advantage that it's faster, you can automate it, and that it's easily available, the bigger disadvantage is that the metric is not able to see what we see as most important to our eyes. So the correlation is the gap there. So this takes us to visual inspection is the key. And obviously leading us to the next section, which is subjective video quality measurement. So with subjective video quality measurement or MOS testing, we all do know that it's a time-consuming and a resource-intensive thing. So when I had to prepare even this for this talk, I did have to ask a lot of my colleagues and friends to at least spend 30 minutes to 1 hour of their time to come and do the subjective testing. So it's a lot of anyone's time, and it's not fast. You cannot automate with this. But the biggest advantage here is that the correlation to human visual system is quite high, since we are the ones who are actually doing these tests. So like I had mentioned before, mean opinion score, or MOS, is the score that I'm using to actually measure the human judged video quality. And the best rating for MOS that has been given for anything in this experiment is 5, and it goes all the way down to 1. I've just color coded this so that, because I've used this in the graphs in the coming slides. And the experiments were carried out under control conditions and in an ITUR recommended settings. And that at least a minimum of 16 subjects did evaluate all of these videos that I have shown the data points for. So this is a slightly heavy slide, so I'm just going to do a recap starting from the graph on the left-hand side. This is a graph that we saw before, four different quality points, bitrate versus PSNR graph, and that between points A and B, we did not see the perceptual difference when we looked at a single frame capture. Now, if you look at the graph on the right-hand side, this is the MOS to bitrate graph that I have plotted over here. And the red color line is the one that's corresponding to the graph on the left-hand side. If you see, the green regions are really high in subjective quality. They are the imperceptible difference between the reference video and the actual compressed video. And the blue band and the red band have less correlation, and there is some sort of a distortion introduced there. So when you look at points A and B, they both are in the green region, in the sense that people who actually viewed these videos were not able to subjectively say the difference. They said that both of them look pretty similar to me. And we just saw it with one frame capture before, but it's actually proven with the MOS data here. And the blue line is for another, for a different 4K test sequence that I encoded with SVT HEVC encoder. So this proves even more that if you go use a MOS scoring of 4.5 or more, and you decide to spend more bits than point B for this particular case, it's not going to make a difference to the end user who's actually watching it. So why spend that many extra bits if they're not able to perceive the difference? So this graph over here is just an additional data point with more 4K contents of the same content type, which I had shown before. Here, the given is the dotted line over there. I am assuming that, I'm saying that 4.5 is a MOS score that we can definitely hit if we use a 13 megabits per second with this specific encoder and specific content type. And I am encoding every other video in the solid line over there with 13 megabits per second bitrate. And as you can see, the assumption did work out, or the theory did work out right, that every video was able to produce a MOS score of either 4.5 or more than 4.5 at the bitrate that we have identified as ideal for our particular case. So the summary from these two slides, we could say that for this particular encoder, which is SVT HEVC software encoder, and for a 4K content of this content type, it's enough if you use 13 megabits per second bitrate, and you should be able to get a MOS score of 4.5 for sure. So this takes us to the recommendation. It's pretty much the flow of the talk until now. I am saying that follow this recommendation so you might be able to semi-automate the MOS score measuring process. So first of all, choose the content type that you want to test for your specific use case. Next, choose a couple of representative videos that you want to test. Plot the bitrate at specific VQ points like I had shown before. And then show all of these videos at specific VQ points to users and measure the MOS scores. Now you have the bitrates at these VQ points and you have the MOS scores at those particular bitrates. So out of those bands that we had seen before, pick which band you want to be in for your particular use case. Choose the corresponding bitrate and then go back and use this bitrate for the rest of the videos in of the same content type in the encoder. So what this does is enables us to make decisions based on actual subjective testing because you're using MOS scores. Yet it can be done on a smaller set of representative videos instead of each and every one of them, and it can be used broadly across a larger content base. We do have to keep in mind that this is specific to the encoder and the content type. And we did see that using this methodology is actually enabling us to save on bits. We are still using subjective analysis, and it's relatively faster than doing MOS testing on each and every one of the contents. So that's pretty much the summary. It's not as fast as objective metrics, agreed. It's not completely automatable, but the biggest advantage we are getting is that we are getting to save a lot on bits, and it's definitely correlatable to HVS. And if you adopt this methodology, you kind of can automate it. You do have to spend some time for the representative set of videos to get the MOS scores, but you do get to automate at least a part of the pipeline. This is just the test environment that I've used. I already talked about the SVT HEVC open source software encoder from Intel. That's the encoder that I've used for the representation. And then the system that I've used is a Xeon D2191, and Linux is the operating system that I had chosen. And all the test sequences that I had shown were downloaded from the openly available media.zif.org. And if you have any questions, reach out to me at my LinkedIn or my Intel ID. And if I was too fast, I apologize for that. I can take any questions.